Dear Lord, help me, mold me, fill me, use me, that the Holy Spirit may deliver my thoughts and words to the places on the hearts of our congregation that need your inspiration. Amen. Full circle. This is something that's been on my heart for a long, long time, so I'm so happy to be able to share it with you, and just the true blessing it has been to have this calling during something that I'm able to be more. So I'm so grateful to be with you today, and I'm going to tell you what it's been like to be me recently. The myth of fingerprints. Paul Simon's Graceland. And I can tell you that music is huge, in case you didn't know that, for me, but the myth of fingerprints is a great song. Every time it says, may you see the fingerprints of God, I'm always thinking about this one. And shortly after the new year, Deb and I get together to discuss this unmistakable calling that I was feeling on my heart. Later that same night, PBS, may God bless them, aired the 21st anniversary Graceland concert. And the Graceland that I was seeking began to speak to me in the middle of the night. Just like Samuel, I had to get up to respond to the strength of the call. And then I had to write down the vision as plainly as I could. I knew clearly, there in the middle of the night, that I had a message on my heart that I needed to share with my church family. So I began thinking through. You've done this, laying there in the middle of the night, thinking about all the things going on in your mind. And so I was just thinking back. And the encapsulation of these eras in my life were three pastors, 3 years, 3 books. There have been other books, I can assure you. But thinking back to my youthful days, there was faith speaking that we have turned into a program to share with the kids. And I read that book and experienced all of that right here with Ken Witt. Flash forward to the 80s to the 90s, then we get into the Monday Connection. And I experienced that book right here with Ken Downs. And then flash forward to 21st century, and I'm told there's the 90s and then there's the noughties of the first 10 years of the 21st century. So the purpose-driven life. It's just one of the books that we've shared with Deb, but there were pieces of those that were going through my mind and telling me, you need to share this. So, it was a little bit like Dickens' Christmas Carol. Where would I have gotten that idea? So there's Scrooge going back through the ghosts. Or maybe a little bit more like George Bailey and Capper's It's a Wonderful Life. But I began revisiting the events of my life shape my faith right here at the Littleton First Baptist. And it was something that I needed to do. My struggle in the night was trying to help me resolve my daily life. So in our home, and trying to be the best parents we could ever be, we were having a few reasons that we won't get into where there were some negotiations about mid-adolescence to the place and value of various family activities. And for this reason, I decided, Sherman, set the way back machine. We're going to go back in time to when I was a youth group right here at Littleton First Baptist Church. How many recognize Mr. Peabody and Sherman? All right, thanks. Glad to have you. We're going back. So here it was. What was it like, Deb? Well, I'm glad you asked, son. And I was president of the youth group here, and I went through the paces. I already mentioned Ken Witt, and I designed a program to share with the youth, and it was a youth paired with an adult mentor. My mentor's still here, thank God. And it was a great time. I really knew who I was. I fit into my community. I had a clear vision of what I wanted to do and who I wanted to be. Ah, yes, it was the Cold War, and we did go see war games and learn the only way to win was to not play the game. gosh, it was fun. That was in the fall, and then in the spring, we did the time show. And that is, I'll make sure Mom gets credit or we reprise this, but Mom is the administrative coordinator of church. We do all these wonderful things for us, so the program over there. Gong show, we ran the gong show. I got to be Chuck Harris, it was a lot of fun, so we bring all the acts through and just have a great evening together. And on the back of that program, it says that what we were doing back in 82 was trying to raise $1,500, so 15 of us could go to Habitat for Humanity. And so that's the crew. If we spent more time on this, I could tell you some of the faces, but I can at least tell you that's me over there. And we went down to Robbins, Tennessee. You already saw one picture about that. And then I also got to go the following year to Green Lake, Wisconsin. And it was, I was 16 turning 17. My birthday happened while I was there. And Kendall put together this letter when we came home, and a fellow friend that I made that said, drone-free pastor from Virginia. And this says here, that's Brenda, folks. So we had her, you know, some good American Baptist youth there. We got some good time. Got through the 80s, went to architecture school, got out of architecture school, got into my young adult life, and the message that we really tried to figure out how to share with the world through the Ken Downs administration was how to share our Sunday faith lives with our Monday work lives. And that lady over there, Pastor Geb, started the whole Teaching Parish Committee movement here at church. She was our first student pastor, and for some reason she asked me to be the chair of her Teaching Parish Committee. And that was pretty cool stuff going on back then. And Sean Bendigo, who was one of the student pastors to follow, and he studied this book, The Monday Connection. And then along came fathering, and in my day job of making homes for families. And then besides that, one weekend a month, our group of friends also served to build community by getting through the big ugly to-do list that we had at our home. So we made a fix-it club. So just once a month, we rotate around to each other's homes, and when you bring three families together and work from 9 to 1, it's pretty amazing what you can get done. Then you have a lunch break and enjoy getting together. And I can tell you another whole sermon, but there's a tugging on my heart too, that the fix-it club is something that could be something valuable for our community. Get back to that another time. But Ken Downs now had a sermon once that I won't forget, and he talked about how many of us live adult-sized lives on a child-sized faith. All right, let's see if this is actually going to work the way I set it up. Into the 21st century and into a maturing faith here now, the purpose-driven life came along. And this has been part of the conversations with my boys as they're getting older. And what is vigor? This is my takeaway from the book. What is your contribution going to be? And then from the book, what is your shape? Yes, it worked. Shape, from the Rick Warren purpose-driven life view of the world, is your spiritual gifts, your heart, your abilities, your personality, and your experiences. So what is it that makes you want to get up in the morning? What can you do for hours without thinking or even noticing the passage of time? And maybe this is the work that is most honest to the God that is in you. And that brings me forward to this point. Faith, not fear. If you haven't heard me say this the last few years, you haven't heard me say much, but I say this a lot. So this goes back to when David and Joyce were here, and the recession, and the last 5 years of trying to figure out how to have anybody care about their homes enough to actually work on them so that I might be able to feed my family. But on we go. So Rick Warren's take on this is, when God is at the center of your life, you worship. When he's not, you worry. I have another tattered little graphic here in my own Bible. And this is from Ellen Hollingworth, mom of Paul Hollingworth, who just passed. And it says, says, if you worry, you do not trust. If you trust, you do not worry. Jesus never fails. Amen. All right, so that's leading me around and back to grace. I love the album. I love the spirit. And if it didn't matter as much to you, this was when world music entered our lives. So Paul Simon was trying to make the world a smaller place. So he went to South Africa and he made some incredibly beautiful music. And he was trying to create his own Graceland. So I'm back to my dream, and I'm wanting a Graceland to be here. So having rolled back those decades, I knew beyond the shadow of a doubt that I had been called to offer some of the pure gold of my youth group experience right here, back to the youth that we're blessed to have with us today. So I called Deb, and I said, can we get together? And we planned the time to talk, and figured out that there probably is something worth sharing here. The spirit was moving, and the idea fits so effortlessly into our liturgical program for our youth community that we were pretty sure we had something. And I felt as though my vision had been blessed. So I'm committed to rolling this out. We'll see how many kids come along with the journey. But it's worked for me. There we are. That's the discipleship program back in 1983. 30 years ago, Sean. Those close to me know that all I ever wanted to be was a good dad. Everything else is ancillary to this main focus. So my heart goes out to all of the parents working this faith journey through with your pride and joy. The fingerprints of God have led me to rolling out this program with Deb's help. And this afternoon, by the way, we begin a journey through Lent with the youth who will come along with us. A little bit more from Stephen Jones. In our ministry with youth, we're partners with God in Christ. Trust that the right opportunities will come along if we are open and ready for them. And finally, let us trust that what we are unable to accomplish with youth, God will accomplish by calling others to join us, both during their adolescent years and beyond. We are summoned to be nurturers of evangelists with youth, but we are not called to be their saviors. A growing faith, a faith that is growing and maturing, is undoubtedly the strongest force for good in the world. That sure is the way it felt 30 years ago, and may it be so again for us. And one more scripture, just for good measure. If our gift be the stimulating of the faith of others, let us set ourselves to it. And I found this ancient Christian prayer in The Way of Discernment, another book that has been part of our life together here. And let me say it as my closing prayer with you. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful, and kindle in us the fire of your love. Send forth your Spirit, and we shall be created, and you shall renew the face of the earth. May it serve God and our LFBC family. Amen. We're doing things a little bit different today, if you haven't noticed.